Hello. I want to thank everybody for coming to for my mom. We're going to start off with my cousin Isaiah. He's going to open us in prayer. The pamphlet's all right, except for I changed the song for my mom because I heard a song and it made me think about her. Because when I was, when my nanny passed, she came and she taught me a lot of things that maybe I didn't like, but I know I have a lot of her in me. And so I changed my song for her, so we'll hear that in a little bit. But my cousin Isaiah's gonna open us up, and then the pastor's gonna talk to us as well. Thank you all for coming.
Good afternoon, everyone. Good afternoon. Good afternoon. Praise the Lord. I'm going to be actually praying this afternoon, but I just wanted to read a quick passage of scripture coming from 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 3. It says, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercy and God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our tribulation, that we may be able to comfort those who are in any trouble with the comfort that which we ourselves are comforted by God. For as the sufferings of Christ abound in us, so our consolation also abounds through Christ." And if we could just all close our eyes and bow our heads as we go before the Lord in prayer this afternoon. So, Father God, we thank you today. Hallelujah. For the life of Darlene, for the life of Dolly. We thank you, God, for the impact. We thank you, God, for the difference that she made in her family. We thank you, God, for the joy, the peace, the kindheartedness, the generosity, God, that she released and imparted into her loved ones, into her friends, and into her family. Father, we pray today that you are the God of all comfort. May you comfort the family today. May you strengthen the family today. May you release peace that surpasses all understanding to guard the hearts and the minds of her loved ones today. Hallelujah. May they know, hallelujah, that you are the God of comfort. You are the God of healing. You are the God who cares for them and is mindful of them. And so we thank you, God, for your presence in this place. We thank you, God, for releasing your grace in this place. We thank you, God, for your hand that rests upon the family here today. Hallelujah. May your word that go forth today, God, encourage, hallelujah, lift up and build up the family members here today, hallelujah, and may your grace be sufficient for them in their time of need, in the mighty name of Jesus, amen, amen, and amen, amen. So I would like to welcome my pastor, one of my mentors, one of my friends, Apostle Brendan Massis. He will be sharing with a word with you guys today for encouragement. Bless you guys.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord. You mind if I take this off? Tracy already told me that there wasn't going to be any long preaching, so I won't be spitting. And so I just want to give you guys a word of encouragement. I'm Brendan Massis from Columbus, Ohio. And though I did not know Dolly, I know her through you. I know her through her niece, and I am blessed to be able to be here to help you in this season of transition. I want to read a verse of scripture. The verse of scripture that you probably all can quote by heart, but I want to lift a verse from Psalm 23. How many have heard of Psalm 23? So Psalm 23 is a verse of scripture that is very familiar. The first verse, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I fear no evil, for you are with me." That's the verse that I want to encourage you guys with today. Even though you walk through the valley and the shadow of death, it's just a shadow. Death is only a shadow. Death is only the doorway into abundant life. Dolly actually is not there. She has transitioned into the real sense of what life is. This life is preparation for abundant life. It's like a seed. You put it in the ground, and it comes up a beautiful flower. You couldn't see the seed, or you couldn't see the beautiful flower in the seed until you put it in the ground. And the scripture says, except a grain of wheat fall to the ground and dies, it abides alone. But if it dies, it bears forth fruit. The real life is on the other side of what we see. She is alive. More alive than she's ever been. And I hear that she was quite lively and funny. She's laughing it up on the other side, looking at us, saying, if you only knew, you would not be shedding a tear for me. Actually, she's probably shedding a tear for us. Because this life has accentuated the shadow or the darkness of the age, especially over the last few years, you know, with the coronavirus and the political conflict and, you know, the racial conflict. Those things the Bible calls birth pains for a new generation or a new age or a new dispensation that's coming. And there have been a lot of people that have passed on in the midst of the birth pains of COVID-19 and in the midst of the birth pains of the conflict and the wars that are in the earth. But these birth pains are a sign that there is a sun on the other side of the shadow, that when that obstacle that's blocking the sun is removed, all the earth is going to see the sun, and all the earth is going to shine bright in the kingdom of God and his dear son. And I want to encourage you today, it's only a shadow. Death is only a shadow. Your life is only a vapor, and it's only the dressing room for the next life. My daughter just got married, my oldest daughter, 23 years old, and it was more difficult than I could have imagined giving her away. You know, I've seen girls get married, and I've seen fathers walk them down the aisle, and they look all, you know, sharp and walking their daughter down the aisle to give her away. And I thought, you know, it's pretty easy. I know the young man. He's a sharp young man, and I like him and love him now as my son-in-law. But when I was actually about to give her away, I didn't realize that I was actually giving her to another family. She would no longer have my name. She was going to have the name of the family that I was giving her to. And I didn't know the family. I know the son, but I didn't know the family. So I was like, what am I doing? I'm giving my daughter to this family. And there was sitting in the sanctuary there. But she was in the dressing room, and she was changing. And all of her bridesmaids, my other daughters, I have five children. I have three daughters and two sons. And all of them were in the dressing room changing. And after they got changed and they got their makeup on, they got their dresses on, some of them, one of them, my daughter is 14, and she looks like she's 21. And I had never seen her dressed like that. And I was like, you stay in the dressing room. And so, but as they came out, they were coming out of the dressing room into the wedding room to be married to the husband. And I thought about that. This life is just a dressing room for the next life. We are going to be married to Christ. How would it be if we got all dressed up for the wedding and just stayed in the dressing room? Once you get dressed up, once you get the makeup on, once you get the dress on, you got to come out of the dressing room and you got to come out into the wedding room and your name changes, your life changes, you will never be the same. This life is the dressing room, and the door, y'all, is death. Death is the door to the fullness of life. Death is the door to new life. Death is the doorway, and since Jesus died on Calvary and took the sting of death, death has no longer power over us. Oh, yeah, we'll miss Dolly, but we can go where she's going and we can see her again. We can go where she's going and we can laugh with her again. We could hear her jokes. We could laugh into eternity. And I want to encourage you guys today that God has scheduled a doorway entrance into eternity for all of us. And you determine which door you walk through. The door of death to life or the door of death to death. Because there's a second death to those that don't choose life. Jesus said, I am come that you have life and that more abundantly. This world is the first life, he said. I am come that you have life. That's where we are right now. The abundant life is the life we will step into when we walk through the door of death. Dolly has walked through that door. Which door will you walk through? I pray for you guys that not only that you will find solace and encouragement in the life of your daughter, your wife, your sister, your aunt, but I pray that you guys would find encouragement in the life of Christ, that as he conquered death, you will too in him. In Jesus' name. I'll be back to close out in prayer after the program. But at this time, we're going to move further into the program. And we're going to have a letter read of Daniel Quinn by Tracy. And so I'm going to ask Tracy to come and read the letter from her son, Daniel.
My brother Dan wrote this letter for our mom, and it says, Dear Mama, I love you with all my heart. You mean the world to me. You are my heart, my soul, my shield, and my backbone, along with everything else. Without you, I am lost. I feel like I have been stabbed in my heart a trillion times, but I am still standing. You told me to be strong and not to be weak, and we have to go through it to get through it. I remember when I told you the doctor said my heart was bigger than normal, and you said, I know, We both have big hearts, and that's what makes us unique. Everyone has a heart, just not as big as ours. You were so real, Mom, that some people didn't understand you. I'm going to miss your personality, beauty, style, along with your green eyes and gold curls that you always loved. You were an amazing woman and always will be in my eyes. Walking down this long road, I don't know how I will make it, but I am blessed to have my children, grandma, dad, sister, my aunties and cousins to help keep my head up and have my back, and I thank all of you for that. There are so many memories and stories that I could go on for days. There is one particular time that I remember when two of your friends came over and one had only one arm, so I called him Captain Hook. Him and his friends had a camper in the front of our house on Beluga Circle, and he had got a settlement for a lot of money. I remember I was sitting in the kitchen, and he was throwing money in the yard, and you raked them up like they were a bag of leaves. That night, you gave me my first $1,000 at the age of 13, and ever since then, I have been all about the Benjamins and saving my money since. I just want you to know that every breath I take is for you. Every step I take is for you. I'm going to miss your beautiful face and smile in the kitchen, along with your famous roast, catfish, fried chicken, and the rest of your wonderful cooking. You will always be missed, and you will always be in my heart. I will keep you alive through myself and my children. One love always, Mama, forever your twin, to be continued. And now we're going to play a song that he wanted to play for her.
All right, so thank you for that song. Is that Dan right there? Bless you, sir, bless you. You're not gonna die young. You're gonna live. You hear me? Yep, you're gonna live, and today is not the end of your life. It's the end of her life, but it's not the end of your life. Today is the beginning of a new day for you. The scripture I read earlier, that when you put a seed in the ground, it dies and it brings forth fruit. That's the context of walking through the valley and the shadow of death. It might cast a shadow on your life, but it's only a shadow. There's fruit that comes out of an individual's death. Something happens in those that are left. I had a father and my mother passed away. My father passed away when I was 32. I'm 55 this year. And something happened in my life. I felt his spirit come upon me as the days after his death. I felt his spirit come upon me, and I felt him in me. Jesus says, when he actually was about to go away, he says, that which was with you will be in you. And that's the Holy Spirit that came after he resurrected and after he ascended back to heaven. When a loved one dies, all the good that they did, that is released back into those that come after them. And so I want to say to you, sir, that there is good coming to you, and there is God coming your way. And wherever you are in your life, that is not where you're going to end up. Yep. That's not where you're going to end up. You're going You're going further, and you're going to see farther than those that have gone before you. In Jesus' name. It just went out. That's the devil. Did you hear what I said? Awesome. Awesome. All right, next time we're going to have memories from the families and friends. So if you guys have a funny situation you can remember from Dolly, or if you guys just want to come and talk about who she was and what she meant to you, we're going to open it up right now for the next 15 minutes, and we're going to ask you to do it for 2 to 3 minutes at the most. But I'm going to ask you to come right now and just give good memories of your loved one.
Man, this is hard. Past couple of years, I didn't have my license. I drove anyways. Never get pulled over, go to jail. I always called my Uncle Tony, like, hey, can I park my car at your house? I'm walking to town. And my Auntie Dolly would always say, yeah, come on down. So I come down there. No matter what, she would either pick me up or take me where I needed to go. Because, I didn't have a license. She always looked out for me. Every time I left the house, she always gave me a bottle of Henny. Like, I know you like Henny. Here you go. I always appreciate from you. You always looked out for me, even though I wasn't doing the right stuff. The driver with no license, you always let me park my car at the house. And I appreciate that.
That's awesome.
Hello, my name is Patrick Brown. I'm an alumni with my friend Darlene Dolly Gibson-Quinn. It's hard to believe, but I'm here from Kirk and Shaw. We go way back. Any alumni in the house? Okay, we got a few back there. Okay, we travel near and far for our loved ones. I'm a deacon. Dolly came in my life at a young age, at junior high school. And I didn't see her for a while. So I'm a believer. Things happen in seasons and for reasons. Reasons we can't understand sometimes, but God puts things in places and you have to kind of cherish what really took place and what happened. I didn't see Dolly for years, but we all had a connection. We were in the same places. We knew the same people. And she had left and moved to Alaska. So through Facebook, we were able to rekindle and catch up. And it got very interesting. And she got to know my family, my daughter, my son, and everything. And as she was reaching out, she was letting me know she was getting ready to leave and move over to Las Vegas. And so we tried to do what we could, being that brotherhood, sisterhood, reach out and do what we could to help a sister. And I hadn't seen her, but it's amazing how the distance and the time we spent not seeing each other for God to put somebody in their life before they go home. You stand there and wonder, what was that about? Yeah. You know, and not just to see her, but come to help her, to be there in her heart, to say, you know, we reached out. And 40 years later, you're back, okay? And to get to meet Tony and talk and socialize and everything. I just give God all the glory for the time she spent, because Dolly, I tell you, she was a real sweetheart. She was a character. She had her ways, but she was genuine. She was real. And in the seventh grade, we used to say she was a little before her time. She was a superstar. In the seventh, eighth grade, one of them kind, you used to run to the classroom window to watch her go by. You know, that was Dolly. I'm keeping it real. And if I ask people today that went to the high school, did you know her? Oh, she was finest. That's what they knew of Dolly. Okay? So she was genuine. She was real. She wasn't conceited. She was down to earth. She was real people. And when I met back with her, she was just the same. We would quiz each other on the Lord. Okay? And growing in our spirituality. And she was also one of my sobriety partners. You know, I'm 27 years total sobriety. And she would say, how did you do it? And we would laugh, say, one day at a time. You know how it works. And she kept it real to say, you know, where we've been through was a challenge for where we're going. Because we didn't lead. We didn't go through this thing, okay? Like this. We didn't start in kindergarten going through the things, but we learned along the way. Then we got back out to receive the Lord and find a home that was eternal, not just a little resting place, but somewhere forever. But along the way, we found out how to love and respect and honor things, and not to try to judge people who hadn't got where we at yet. Because you still got to walk. The way you came is not the way you're going to leave, as you said, you know. We all have a place in this life. You know, we've looked at some people and say, you ain't going to never be no good. You'll never get it right, but that wasn't your call. Because God didn't take the ones that was really messed up to. He didn't take the ones that were already seemed like little angels. He took the ones that was really had a testimony of pain, cheaters, and murderers, and turned them around to show you the power in him. It wasn't for us to change nobody, and you still can't. That's God's thing. So I love her. I appreciate her. I appreciate the time, but I appreciate the way God made the absence and brought her back before she got ready to go. And my theory, this is my theory, You don't recognize people in heaven like we see each other. You got the face, the eyes, the gray hair, and the short and tall. You recognize spirits, warm spirits, good spirits. So when you get there, we'll know each other by spirit. If we didn't see each other for 50 years. So I came into your life at the end so we could know each other in the spirit. Because I can't look at you and say, I remember you, but I feel the spirit. And if the spirit is not good, to my knowledge, you won't be there. Okay? You'd be somewhere else with people with a lot of bad spirits. So it's a blessing, and I thank you. Rest in peace, Dolly. I love you.
It's always been that way. I'm Desiree, Tracy's friend. Some of you know me. I'm a little nervous. There's so much to say about Dolly. From the beginning, she's always supported me. Everybody knows I had Shy Young. I would always come over there. She'd always feed Shy snacks. She always let us come over there and play. She's always told me to keep going, stay in school, graduate, and she's always been like that. Even when I started the business, she started always supporting me and recommending me to everybody and always had her back. We're going to miss her. We love her. My favorite story about her is one thing, you know, she don't play about her kids, Tracy. It's a little inappropriate, but he was on Southern fighting. It was me. Jumped out the car, beat some girl's ass. Sorry. And then my sister got out and fought her sister. And then it looked like Tracy's about to get out. And then here he's come, Dolly, coming in the car, opened the door, got out the car, was that same what's up. She wasn't about to let Tracy fight. She was about to fight for Tracy. But that just lets you know who Dolly is. She had her kids' back no matter what. And we love and appreciate her. And we're going to miss her spirit. We're going to miss going out to eat with her and her always complaining.
Oh, yeah.
No matter what the food was, Dolly was complaining. She's like, take this back. This is soggy. This is done too well. Take it back. And me and Kendall would just be sitting there laughing. Tracy would be annoyed. And me and Kendall are laughing. I have, like, so many Snapchats of us out to eat, and she's just complaining, and Tony's irritated. Tracy's irritated. But we're laughing because we know how Dolly is. We're going to miss her coming to the parties, bringing the bottles, being lit with us. And then always staying afterwards, making sure nobody's stealing at Tracy's house. Nobody can be in her house, nobody's stealing. And then she's always cleaning up after us as well. And then talk shit about us the next day. Your friends didn't stay clean up. But we're going to miss her and we love her.
Yeah. Okay, I'm just going to tell a quick story of how I met her. I actually met her before I met Tracy. Her and my mom knew each other. And we happened to be like at a salon or something, and we were sitting in the waiting area, and she's talking to my mom, and I'm like, who is this loud lady? I mean, because she was a character, and she was like, I can't remember everything she was saying, but I was just like, wow, she is super loud. And then like a year later, I became friends with Tracy and went over her house, and I'm like, oh, the loud lady is your mom. There she is. I mean, she's you definitely, if you met her, you didn't forget her. And we're going to miss her, for sure.
Right, goodbye. See you later.
See you later.
One more. Anybody else?
This is a hard one. I've been knowing Dolly since I was a kid. Dolly used to be at my house all the time. And Dolly had ran away from home.
Can't hear you.
Dolly had ran away from home, and she is staying at our house. And we stayed on the third floor, all the girls. So Dolly would We would sneak her in the house, and they would come downstairs, go out the front door, and come in the back. And my mother would be sitting at the kitchen table, and she would knock on the door and act like she was just coming in. But my mother knew she was in the house. Because, you know, we stayed in East Cleveland, and we were a community. And you couldn't do nothing, and the parents didn't know. So that went on for a while, but she was, you know, like he said, Dolly was a beautiful woman, young girl, and every guy loved her. Everybody loved her. And every time I told somebody she had died, the only thing they said, she was still beautiful. And they like, wow. This has been a hard pill for me to swallow. She was my sister's best friend. And me and her would talk every day, twice a day, three times a day. And she would get mad with me because I'd be like, Dolly, I'm on Zoom. I'm on a church meeting. Call me back. Dolly, I'm on a meeting. Call me back. You always on meetings. Why? Dolly, I'm doing something for the Lord. Please call me back. And she'll call me back and then she's like, well, where you at now? I'm out. Well, when you coming down here? I'm like, I'm coming. January, I drove down here. And I'm like, I was fussing. Because she sat there and told me, oh, you ain't coming. And I'm like, okay, Dolly, I'm coming. 3 o'clock in the afternoon, she like, you not coming. I'm like, Dolly, I will come. And I'm like, it's 3 o'clock. I said, okay, if I leave at 6, what time will I get there? She said, 9. I had no clue. I had to go through the mountains, the highways, the byways. I was fussing. And I brought my granddaughter. My granddaughter said, Granny, you cannot drive in dark. I'm like, you know what? Dolly, don't ever ask me to come back down here at night. 2 days later, I stayed 3 days. She failed. That Friday, I turned right back around and was back right back down here. I'm like, why is you falling? I'm back. And I was down here for a week, and she like, I had a great time because you know what? God wanted me and her to be together, just me and her. And me and her had a great time. We argued, we fought, and we had a great time, but that was just me and her time. And I'm gonna miss that time. And I've been missing the time. She's like, I'll call you at 3 o'clock in the morning. You supposed to be woke. You said you'd be up at 3 o'clock in the morning. I'm like, I just ain't answering my phone because I wanted to go to sleep. Then you turn around and call me at 9 o'clock. I wanna be asleep. I miss them calls. I just love her. It's just, God took an angel. But she's in a better place.
Amen. Amen.
So we want to close this service with prayer. And I have one more scripture that I want to. Oh, is there a song? Okay. Oh, yeah. Where are we at? Okay, the best is. Okay. All right, you can cue the song. much better.
Can everybody hear me? Mm-hmm. Okay. All right. I just want to tell everyone, thank you so much for coming. I am Dolly's sister, mm-hmm. baby, as she always called me, baby. Mm-hmm. But I just want you to know, it just hit my heart to let you know that life is short, and you really have to keep yourself together. Because it's good out here, and you just have to keep giving it to God.
Yeah.
Because I know I will see my sister again.
Yeah.
That's why I'm not so broken.
Yeah.
Because I know I will see her again.
Yeah.
But you have to live life to your fullest. Because if you don't, you wind up losing it, and you lose people like Dolly. Because she had a lot on her, and I knew that because she talked to me all the time. Mm-hmm. But the thing is, I always tried to give her a good word of advice from the God. That's all I could do because I couldn't travel because I'm from Arizona, and it takes 3 days to drive here. I can't fly, and I can't drive. But I was going to come and see my sister, and I didn't care what. But the thing is, I'm telling you, don't let life mess you up. Keep yourself straight. Be strong because God is good all the time.
Yeah. Yeah.
He will always be there for you.
Yeah.
So if you lean or you hurting or something, give it to him. He'll take it, and he'll be there for you. Yeah. Believe in that.
Yeah.
That's all I had to say.
Yeah.
Thank you.
You're welcome. So she just gave the altar call. And I just want to back her up. And invite you. I know a lot of times, you know, in our religious circles, we make receiving Christ about what we do or what we can do or our behavior. But really, Christ died on Calvary for your sins so that you would not have to pay the penalty for your sins, which is eternal death, which eternal death is forever being separated from God. And so today, if you are here, not about you being perfect, not about you walking a tightrope in this life, but it's about you acknowledging Jesus as your Savior that takes your sins and gives you his life, I want to pray for you. I just want to pray as we close. I just want to pray that you would go through that same door of death to eternal life and that you would see Dolly again in joy. There's a verse of scripture that as you guys were talking about her, I was reminded of a scripture that says, in his presence, there's fullness of joy, and at his right hand, there are pleasures forevermore. And the backdrop of that scripture, Tracy, is that Jesus had died and they thought he was going to take them out of colonialism and slavery to the Romans. And so they thought he was their Messiah to save them. But then he dies on the cross and their hopes are dashed and they thought death was the end. 3 days later, he rises again. And when he revealed himself to them in his glorified state, in his resurrected body, there was fullness of joy at the fact that though they saw him die, they also now saw him alive again, taking authority from death and releasing life eternal life into the earth. And I'm thinking about Dolly and all the joy that she brought to so many. And many of you are missing her right now. And many of you feel like that, you know, this is the end. But no, you're going to see her again. And there is going to be joy unspeakable and full of glory if you walk through the door that she walked through to eternal life. And so if that's you, if you want to walk through that door that is provided through Jesus Christ, just raise your hand. I want to pray for you. I see that hand. I see that hand. I see that hand. Bless you. I see that hand. I see that hand. I see that hand. I see those hands. All right. All right. So just everybody repeat this prayer after me. As you pray this from your heart, you position yourself to receive all that God has for you in this life and in the life to come, eternal life. Like I said, it's no tightrope, you know, walking a the road is narrow, but he's already walked it for you. And when you get off base, when you get off course, Isaiah was talking about the prodigal son today. Everybody heard the story of the prodigal son? You know, we hear the story about the prodigal son a lot, but the older son, when the prodigal son came home after having lived with the harlots, lived in drunkenness, he came home to his father, and his father gave him a party. The older son got mad because the older son had been in the house. He wasn't partying. He had been in the house. He didn't spend his father's inheritance on prostitutes. He had been in the house, and he's like, what's this party for? I've been here all this time, and you never threw a party for me. And the father said, well, son, all of this was yours. You could have had a party anytime you wanted. But this, my son, was dead, and now he's alive. Should not we party that he is now alive? And I'm telling you, you might not walk the narrow, straight road in this life, but he already did it for you. And when you get to that next life, he's going to be saying, hey, come. Come on in. Let's throw a party. They made it. Throw a party. And all the other religious folk, they're going to be looking like, wait a minute, how she get in? How he get in? Wait a minute. Hey, whoa. I could see Jesus looking at him. It's like, well, you could have been whatever, you know, you could have had all this all the while. I want to pray, and I want you to repeat this prayer after me, and I want to assure that you see Dolly in joy. Say this. Say, Jesus, I believe you are the Son of God. I believe you died for my sins. I believe you are alive forevermore. Come into my life. Forgive me of my sins. Cleanse me of my attitudes. Cleanse me of my bad thinking. Give me your mind. Give me your heart. Thank you, Jesus, for taking my place. Thank you, Jesus, for giving me your life. Say this. Say, Satan, you are no longer my God. I will not serve you. Go from me now. Go from me now. Jesus is Lord. Jesus is my Lord. Amen. Amen. Come on, give the Lord a hand clap praise. Come on, y'all could do better than that. Clap like you will when you see Dolly again. Now, Father, I thank you for the life of Miss Darlene. I thank you, Lord, for the fruit of her life. Yes, Lord. These that have received you into their heart. I thank you, God, that even in her death, she has produced life. And so now, God, I pray that these that have come to know you will see you and encounter you whether in dreams, whether in visions, as they read the word, let them see you, let them encounter you in their spirit, as they hear your voice, as they're walking down the road or maybe doing something, ain't no business doing, they will hear your voice clearly saying no. Let them see you and let them encounter you. Lord, I pray a blessing over them. Even, Lord, as Jesus died and shed his blood so that healing would be released, I pray a blessing of healing over this congregation, this people. I declare now COVID-19 will not be able to attack or come into their body. I declare that they are covered by the blood of Jesus. I declare no plague will come nigh their dwelling. I declare their children are blessed. I declare their grandchildren are blessed. I declare that their finances are blessed. I declare promotion and increase on their jobs. I release business ideas. I release understanding of investments for investment properties. Father, I ask you to bless them. Keep them. Make your face to shine upon them. Be gracious unto them. Lift up your countenance upon them and give them peace in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 I want you to get up and I want you to hug three people and I want you to tell them you love them. I want you to get up and hug two or three people and tell them you love them. You are dismissed.